He's straight away, guys.
Umpires have had a good night. There he is. He said, I'm going to get to one more stoppage. And guess what?
He didn't.
He didn't quite make it.
Now it's
but
real.
He may get an opportunity now.
Now it's really time to get a few Geelong Stars off.
Yes. There he is. He's circling. Can he claim one more? He's probably thinking in his mind. What a huge win this has been for the Cats. They are going to win this game and go into another prelim final. And they do it. And they win by 35 points. And Geelong play Melbourne in the prelim next Friday.
We are Geelong, the greatest team of all. We are Geelong, we're always on the ball. We play the game as it should be played.
BT, it's been injury carnage.
Oh, it'd be great if he could get anywhere near his best side.
To pass, yeah. Pass, easy pass for GWS this year. Yeah.
Plenty to get excited about as well. Lockie Ash, pretty good again tonight. Sam Taylor, we know Iden played a role all year. Cumming, Tom Green, who wasn't out there tonight. Even Hopper's only 24, and Stone comes in and didn't let anyone down tonight.
Joel Selwood tonight also breaking the game's record. I think we'll see both sides stay out for that. And that is an outstanding feat in itself. But if there is one man that never wants it to be about him, it's Joel Selwood.
And what about the football-loving fans in this state? Got a Sydney team and a Melbourne team. And 40,000 people next Friday night, as BT said, they get the Demons and the Cats in a prelim. Got to think that's going to be well represented. So here we go. Port Adelaide already there. They're waiting for the winner of Brisbane and the Dogs. And next Friday night, that is going to be a ripper. Demons could not be in better shape, and the Cats bouncing back hard.
I think the 200th win, some sort of record between Selwood and Hawkins as well, JB. We're going to be speaking to a player or two in a minute. We can't send X out onto the ground. It has to be done through their media people. We thank them for their efforts.
Just go through the Cats. They found their brand again tonight, I think. The moments of control and patience out of their back half, but they had another gear where they generated a bit more speed. And their pressure was right back.
So is this the last we see of Shane Mumford? Not giving much away. Stevie J, of course, three-time premiership Cat, but then finished his career playing for the Giants and now a big part of their coaching structure.
So I think we might be going down to Tommy Hawkins in a moment, JB.
Chris Scott, a happy man, and he is, of course, huge fan of Joel Selwood, as are we all. We might have the big Hawk on mic now. You got us, big Tommy?
Yes, JB, I'm here.
Hey, well played. Fine game of footy from yourself. And as Daisy just said, a great bounce back for the Cats.
Yeah, look, it was hard fought. The side in GWS that we had trouble with a couple of weeks before, and I thought we were outstanding. Led through the midfield. We had contributors all over the ground, which we probably lacked last week. So a really pleasing effort for us. We keep our season alive and we move on, stay in Perth. We're going to rock and roll out of quarantine and give it a crack next week.
Tommy, congratulations. Another prelim final. Like you said, you give yourself a chance. Come up against an up-and-coming defender tonight in Taylor. Did a really good job on you last time. How much time did you put into him during the week?
Look, to be honest, Wayne, I've always tried to concentrate on what I do really well, so try and play to my strengths, and I feel when I'm at my best, I can play well against anyone. So I obviously know that he liked to sit off from last time I played on him. He's obviously got great closing speed and really good in the contest. But I mean, late we started to move the ball inside 50 with non-pressured entries. The ball carrier had a bit of time and space, and that's always really hard to stop as a defender.
Tom, congratulations. Your coach was pretty frank last week, just said anything that could go wrong did, and you couldn't get any forward pressure on. But from the get-go tonight, your pressure was right up. Was that a player-led thing or something you trained or a coach directive? What shifted tonight?
We were clearly poor last week in that area. I thought it's a tricky one because obviously we want to be able to put on forward pressure and make it a hallmark of our game with inside forward 50, but we need to play well collectively to allow small forwards, well, anyone down the forward line to put pressure on. So it was a collective effort, collective buy-in. I thought that was outstanding. We talked about it at three-quarter time. Brad Close led that. Brian led that with a forward 50 tackle, holding the ball, and we kicked the goal off the back of Brad Close. So that was outstanding and really pleasing for us.
Hey, last one, Hawk. You ran into your old teammate, Big Mummy. Might have just given you a nice corky to enjoy during the week.
You know what? The funny thing I said to Shane was that, and I played a bit of footy with Shane, so I respect him immensely, but Nigel Lappin told me during the week, he said, watch out for Mummy when he sits off the contest. He runs in for that knee and wants blood. So he got me right smack bang in the corky. I was expecting it, but couldn't do anything about it.
Congratulations, mate. Go and enjoy.
I will. Thanks, guys.
Tom.
They mightn't have a great record in qualifying finals, but they are the best at bouncing back in week two of the finals. And they've done it again, 35 points, the final margin. And another piece of the finals puzzle has been locked away. That means that Geelong will go on to face the D's in the preliminary final at Optus Stadium next week.
Extraordinary effort, 11 preliminary finals in 15 years. Bucks the trend in the modern game. The system's not designed for that. I'm not sure even the great Hawthorn team's made that many prelims in a row, Jace, in that span during the 80s when you were playing. But not a great game of football, but they did what they had to do. They got exciting late in that start of that last quarter, but well done to Geelong. They deserve to be in there next week.
Welcome to the post-game brought to you by Industry Super Funds. When it comes to super, there's only one symbol to look for. It was a result that was never really in doubt, really, even though for a brief moment in the early part of the fourth term, we thought, maybe, just maybe.
Yeah, they needed to be perfect, the Giants, didn't they, if they were going to really mount a challenge. This is a great moment here.
Yep.
Joel Selwood went about it in typical Selwood fashion, didn't he?
How good to see Corey Enright, one of the men cheering off, who played 332 games,
yeah.
And he goes past him tonight with game number 333, the most games ever by a Geelong player.
Yeah, great
good
moment.
Effort.
Great moment.
It's ironically, too, they said a lot of the knocking him coming through recruiting-wise, but his knees stuffed.
Yeah,
already.
I remember
he won't make 100 games, so
yep.
I think about half the club doctors in the AFL put a line through him. And ironically, I think the knee's been the least injured thing he's had over his whole career. He's been knocked in the head plenty of times.
Didn't go as early in the draft as he should have because a few teams were scared off by the old knee report. But boy, what a find he's been for the Geelong Football Club. What a great leader, and fitting that he should break the game's record at the club that he loves so much. And a pretty relaxed looking Chris Scott now. We spoke to him pre-game. He looked very solemn, didn't he? It was all business-like.
All business. And it's the same right now. I mean, this is business as usual.
Is he already thinking about next week?
100%. 100%. He's already thinking about the areas of the game that they're going to have to improve, because they will need to improve on that performance if they're going to trouble Melbourne next week. We'll get into the last time they met.
So very, very shortly. A big win. Let's hear the Cats enjoy the song. Vocal as I thought they might be, so that tends to make you think they've got bigger things in mind.
They might have seen the coach on the way in. Just seen that he wasn't getting excited, so it wasn't the time for them. But they've been here before. Like you said, Browning, 11 prelims in 15 years. Mm. Phenomenal. Yep. Missed the finals twice since 2004. So you talk about Joel Selwood, this is all he knows. Yeah, imagine going through your whole career.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Another prelim.
Just before we do a deep dive, let's head back to Optus Stadium. Matthew Pavlich, did you see enough from the Cats tonight to suggest they might be able to get past the D's next week?
To be honest, Jason, no, I didn't. I thought it was just a really professional performance from the Cats. Nothing that really would have scared the D's that were sitting back at their hotel here in WA watching the game and really worried them about a prelim next week. Clearly, they're going to go and get it done and live up to the hype and live up to the expectation and the pressure Melbourne next weekend. But just a professional performance from the Cats. We come to expect that for such a long period of time. 11 prelims, as you've been talking about, over the past 15 years. They just keep getting the job done. Their senior players stood up in the moments that really mattered. The Giants kept coming and coming, but they couldn't land a knockout blow because they were just so sound the way they played, and they're able to kick enough. And I think what we saw tonight, the only thing that may worry the Demons is that mix of Radaglia and Rowan and Cameron and Hawkins, if they can get enough supply, that could worry a Melbourne defence. But a pretty impressive performance. 44,000 people really enjoyed the game here as well in the stadium. So looking forward to next week.
Pav, hard to follow in the studio here, but you kept a close watch on Dangerfield all night. Did he look like he was getting back towards his best in the second half?
Yeah, second half, Brownie, I think you're right. They dropped that tag that Matty DeBoer was pretty hard going to him in that first half, but they dropped that off a little bit, and he started to find a bit more form as the game opened up. And he's obviously had that stop-start preparation all year, that ankle injury. He's had a number of concerning issues with his body, but he's been able to find some form in that second half. And I think everyone wants to see a fit and firing P. Dangerfield come prelim final time.
Hey, Pav, a crowd of 44,000 tonight. I'm not sure how many Giants supporters live over in the West. I think next week, playing the D's, could we see a sellout, do you think, for the prelim?
I think so. Well, believe it or not, there was a fair bit of orange and a fair bit of noise once the Giants did kick a goal. But I think you're right. Next weekend, there's lots of Melbourne fans here in Perth that will be very, very keen to make amends from a couple of years ago when they, I guess, got crunched and smashed by the West Coast Eagles in a prelim. But lots of Geelong support tonight. And I can tell you, lots of Melbourne support next Friday night. It's going to be a huge game here.
Thank you, Pav. Appreciate your contributions tonight. That is going to be a massive match. The action kicks off right here on Fox Footy from 7 p.m. You will not miss a beat. The D's and the Cats, who played a thriller in round 23. Now they go at it again. Time now to talk about our Ford Ranger player of the match. And there's really only one man we could come up with. Tom Hawkins did it all tonight. He was beaten by Sam Taylor. Last time they played, he made amends tonight.
Yeah, and he was quiet last week too. This takes a lot of mental fortitude to be able to do what Tom Hawkins has done, because when a defender's had your measure as recently as Sam Taylor had, I mean, that can play tricks on your mind. But I thought the adjustment from Tom Hawkins was really clever, Brownie. With his positioning, he got him up the ground. He got him to positions where he wasn't just a sitting duck for Taylor to be able to sort of use him as a reference point and go and intercept, like what happened last time.
Yeah, that's right. I thought he played him too deep last time, and yeah, the Cats mids had to release the ball. So playing deeper allows the defender player in front. The further up the field you go, well, then it becomes difficult for the defender to play in front of you then. He's got to protect goal side. So I thought Tommy's position was good. He set up the game the first half, and then the second half really cashed in, didn't he? He was able to work his way back closer to the goal.
Well, it was a fascinating battle to watch. And Nick Rewalt, when we look at the numbers, it tells a pretty nice tale in the favour of Tom Hawkins, doesn't it?
It's a massive game. Yep. It's a massive game. As good as Taylor was the first time, he was the best man on the ground. Hawkins flipped the script entirely. I mean, you can see there, it wasn't just the fact that he hit the scoreboard himself. It was the fact that he got involved around the ground. He was a focal point. He took relieving marks up the ground that then caused the overlap and set them up further afield. So it was a complete Ford's performance.
Hey, we've got a thrill right now, Brandon. We're going to head back to Optus Stadium because Jeremy Cameron has been good enough to get wired up and have a chat to us. Jeremy, appreciate your time, mate. Congratulations. A fantastic night. A great performance. Tell us how it felt facing off against your old team for the very first time.
Yeah, it was certainly a strange feeling before the game, coming up against my old mob. I thought I missed out, you know, early in the year, about 5 weeks ago when we played them at home. But, yeah, it was a good game. We knew that they'd come out firing, and that's how they've played their footy over the last month. And it was a really good battle, and it was good to, you know, come away with the win in the end.
Jeremy, there was a good little exchange earlier. You flew for a mark. It might have been Harry Perriman you cleaned up, and then it was on. But you were doing it with a smile on your face while it was all unfolding.
Yeah, that's it. You know, that's something that we've spoken about during the week, because over the last couple of weeks we've let opposition teams mark it on us. So that was a focal point for us. And yeah, Pez is a man that goes back with the flight often, and he's done that his whole career. I love the guy, and he did it again on that occasion. So it's good to have a scrap.
Jez, it must have been good to get a couple under your belt early. I'm not sure there's been a player or a team under more scrutiny in recent times than the Cats coming into this week, and you in particular having been that player that they seemed to bring in to get them over the hill. Did you feel that during the week, and how did you deal with it?
Yeah, to be honest, I didn't feel it at all during the week. It was a really relaxed week for me. The boys get into me quite often because I sleep for outrageous hours. Most days I'm getting up at, you know, 10:30, 11 o'clock this morning. I got up, so it makes the day shorter for me, and I can just roll out here and do the thing that I love, and that's play football.
That must be the secret. That's Jason Dunstall's program. You stay in bed till about lunchtime.
Oh, please, come on.
Don't need a pack of M&Ms, though, while you're lying in bed. How is it playing with the big Tom Hawk down there? We've lauded him tonight. He's best on ground. He's magnificent. He bounced back after Sam Taylor beat him a few weeks ago, mate.
Yeah, definitely. He's a really great mentor, not only for myself, but for the whole forward line. And he's a really big focal point for us. Clearly, you know, Sam Taylor beat him last time, but it's more so if we pull that game apart, we didn't really kick it to his advantage that night. And tonight, I believe that, you know, we did really put it to his side. And once you get it to his advantage, he's so strong, and we know what he can do. So it was a fantastic game for Tommy.
Something to look forward to next week, Jeremy. We know there was a great clash in round 23 against the D's. Now you front up against them in a preliminary final. That's going to be massive.
Yeah, that's why you play football, for the really big games like this. So it's going to be huge. We didn't play in that not too long ago. It was only a couple of weeks back. So it's pretty fresh in the memory. They you know, steamrolled us late. So plenty of learnings out of that game as well. And we're looking for a good showing.
Jez, you tasted similar at your time in the Giants prelims and obviously grand finals. Does it feel any different being a part of this Cats group?
No, it doesn't feel too different, you know. They're just big games, and I guess the game styles are slightly different, and that took a bit of learning for me, especially missing a number of weeks with injury throughout the year. But, they're just big games, and like I said, I love playing football. It's so fun being out there on the field and to play in the big games in front of big crowds, and everyone watching on at home in lockdown is going to be huge. So, we're going to turn up and make sure it's a good show.
You're a star of the game, played another big one tonight. We appreciate your time, Jeremy, and wish you the very best of luck next week, mate. Thank you.
No worries, guys. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
He is an absolute ripper, yeah. Jeremy Cameron. Hey, we spoke pre-game about stoppages, clearances, contested possessions, and the ability to score from those, Brownie. Well, that was a pretty telling factor tonight, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. We were trying to sell the story of who wins before the game. Yep. So, right, the Giants going to win.
Yeah.
It's on the back of their Giants stoppage game. They're number two in the comp. Their points from clearances the last month, and the Cats were number 15 for defending those points from clearances. But tonight, they turned the table. 7-3, I think it was, from those stoppages. So, well done to the Cats there, and the Giants just weren't able to stop it. And ultimately, that was the difference, really, in the end, and that's really what set up that match-winning lead, especially in that last quarter. And we saw some, I think, two or three goals in the second half. Good clearance there from Hawkins over to Smith.
I think if you try to break down the why, well, why did it happen like that? I think it's as simple as just Geelong had more class in front of the footy. So when you get a stoppage and you're against the Giants, we know, we've spoken about it all night, they're one-on-one defensively. When you've got class players, you're more likely to win those one-on-ones. And that's what they did. They got it in there and they capitalised.
Great action in the lab there from zero. And that's a real contrast here, isn't it? 55 points from stoppages. Hey, let's head into the lab now. Catch up with John, into the...
what do we call it? The newsroom. Something along those lines, isn't it?
Ralphie's.
Ralphie, I know you're there wherever you might be, whichever room it is. It doesn't really matter. What's happening with the Cats now?
Well, here are the stats for you, boys. No, hang on. I am the Geno, aren't I? So Geelong know the score by now. Another week of quarantine, another week in the trade winds there at Fremantle, another week of training at very close facilities there. They love it. They're really comfortable there, and they get to come out on Friday night in front of a full crowd, and then they absolutely will have a massive crack at Melbourne. I mean, it's just going to be a magnificent scenario for them right now. Geelong will play that preliminary final without Brandon Parfitt, who has that what you think would be a minimum of 3-week hamstring strain. Tom Hawkins will be fine, just a corky now. He's had a million of those across his career and will know how to handle that and how to get back to his best for that Friday night contest. The interesting one is Tom Stewart, who suggested on a couple of radio interviews today that he would start running over the weekend with that Lisfranc fracture. We know that he did it in round 21. Now, Dr. Peter Larkins has said that it would just be insane for him to think that he's any chance. I think delusional was his expression, to think that he's a chance to get up for a grand final. But certainly, he's going to ramp up that fitness over the weekend and see whether that foot can hold some kind of loads there. So, look, the Giants. Jason McCartney, their football boss, told me an hour before the bounce that Shane Mumford will definitely retire. Now, of course, he's tried that before and he came out of retirement last year. His issue is, as he told me, that he could probably play next year, but it's the load that it takes and what it would do for his body over the next 50 years. They just don't believe they can put him through that, given, of course, all the degenerative issues there. Bruce, Briggs, Flynn, you know, they're all available as ruckmen, so they will take up the cudgels and they will lead the ruck stocks next year. So Jacob Hopper will sign a 2-year deal in coming weeks. Stephen Cornelio is the interesting one. He's contracted. He's not interested in leaving. I know he was really poor tonight and he'll be heavily criticised over that over the weekend. Ankle surgery in round 3. He came back from that, a really serious toe injury that was as a result of some of the issues with that ankle. Look, he was hobbling tonight. It was the worst possible preparation through the season. He will go out there and he'll have a fantastic pre-season. And to be honest, with Toby Green's issues there, he put paid to his captaincy aspirations. They don't need more picks. They've got pick 2 and 15 leading into the draft. They just need their captain to play really well and to lead well, and that's very much what I expect he will do over the summer and into next year.
Thank you, Ralphie. We'll let you go and get ready for Wreck-It Ralph, which is coming up shortly. We must also say congratulations to Shane Mumford. What a star he's been. He has put through, he's put his body through absolutely everything you could and then a little bit more for the Giants. So they dragged him out of retirement once.
Tell you what he's been. He's been great entertainment.
Oh, hasn't he?
Hasn't he been good to watch? He's been so good to watch. The game's going to be poorer for not having him smack blokes everywhere.
He's got to look after himself because the only time he doesn't have an ice pack on him is when he actually plays those 2 hours on a weekend. It's astonishing.
So Mummy's not going to be there for you to have a coffee with. No. Who are you going to find?
Well, we're going to have a serious coffee this week, and I'm going to need to bring you boys in with me, okay? So we've got Steve Cornelio at the cafe. Now, yes, he's had some serious injuries. Some operations, he's clearly below his best. Let's go back to 2018, 2019, when he's averaging about 27 disposals a game and 5 or 6 clearances a game. He's reportedly on $1 million. Let's knock it back to 800 in COVID times, OK? So, obviously, clearly he's under-delivering. He missed a lot of football. He needs to go away. And, yes, get himself healthy, have a good, solid pre-season. But I would now... I know the question's around Toby Green saying he doesn't deserve to be captain... But I would say relieve the stress on you, Stephen. Go away and focus on yourself. Get yourself healthy, get yourself right without the added stress of being the captain. Toby has proved that he can be a very good captain. He needs to get rid of some of that other, you know, the peripheral stuff, the incidents.
But, he's not going to get rid of those peripheral things.
No, I reckon if you give him the permanent captaincy, I reckon he may. It might be the catalyst, the instigator to get him going. But I just think this is more about Stephen Cornelio. Get yourself back to your best and relinquish the captaincy. I think it'll ultimately help you as a player and then you're more value to the Giants in the long run.
I don't think he needs to relinquish it. I think he'd welcome the conversation because he looks uncomfortable with the title of captain.
He does, doesn't he?
He looks uncomfortable with it, I think. So if it's not Toby Green, I mean, Josh Kelly's just recommitted to the club for a very long period of time. He's had a bounce-back year. He's had a really good year of football as well. So there are players there that can step up. I think in the void. Taranto, we know he's a great young player and plays the right way. So it's not like they're devoid of choice. And if it frees him up, if it allows him to at least do what you said and focus on the other things that he can control, well, then I think it's a win for everyone.
I think it's an enormously stressful situation to be, as the captain of the club, to be worrying about your own spot in the team. Like, you know, when you're presenting, say, he does a press conference during the week and you can see it in his eyes. He's lacking confidence in himself and his position there. So I just think you maybe clear that responsibility from.
For me, it's not so much the captaincy. I think it's the fact that he knows he can't impact a game the way he wants to. He's nowhere near the ability to run, the speed, the strength, the power to keep your feet in those one-on-one contests. How many times did we see him go to ground tonight? So for me, it's all about him getting confidence back in his ability to lead on the field by action.
Yeah, that's right. So, but when you don't have the confidence in your own ability to be able to do those things, how do you stand in the huddle before the game and eyeball each of your teammates and demand supreme effort, demand excellence, demand adherence to role? You can't. You can't do it, Jase.
Are you saying you have to be a star player to be a captain? Because we've had some great role-playing captains.
100% we have. But captains that have confidence in their ability to play a role. I think right now he doesn't have confidence. Yeah. That's what you're talking about.
On the freight that he's on, he has to be a star player. You can't be a small role player if you're on that sort of freight.
No, I understand that. So understand that.
Are you saying he needs to just get healthy and get his confidence back that way by being healthy, back himself in that way?
I just think we're talking too much about the captaincy and not enough about his lack of confidence and lack of physical strength to deliver what he wants to deliver on the football field. So that's the problem. And it's a very fine line where we're balancing when do I come back and play, even though I'm supposedly fit to play but I can't have any impact, is it better that I don't play? How do you get that right?
It's a balance. They've got to find a solution because right now he's on, like you said, big freight that could be club crippling if they're not able to turn him back into the player that he was. And maybe freeing him of that added responsibility is the quickest ticket to do that.
Big freight shipping costs have gone up in recent years, haven't they? Hey, they did have one highlight. The Giants, the goal to Bobby Hill tonight, early in the third term. This was something special.
Goal of the year in finals, Jase, do they care?
He looked like Kyrie Irving here along the wing with the handles. Unbelievable. What about the ball control?
That was unbelievable. Yeah, it was great to see. It's one of the goals of the year, if not the goal of the year. I'm not sure they count in finals, but well done to him.
It felt like it was going to be the igniter, wasn't it, in that second half to get the Giants really up and about. The trouble
it ignited Geelong. They kicked
the next
five.
Yeah, that's right. They rattled off five in a row.
All right, well, we know they played back in round 23. It was an engaging contest down at GMHBA Stadium. These are the numbers, and there's no wonder when you look at them, the fact that there was virtually nothing between them at the end.
Well, it took a shot after the siren to separate them, didn't it? It was unbelievable. But it was 40-minute periods of dominance for both teams. Obviously, Geelong got out to the 44-point lead. So I think both sides will then take away a little bit of method that they will try to get the game to replicate when they meet again. Geelong, with their control, they really forced the Melbourne defenders to come out. They just didn't blast away to them. So that element of control, and then Melbourne got on top and absolutely steamrolled them in the second half. So a lot to like for both teams.
Yeah, looking forward to the matchup. We've got Wreck-It Ralph coming your way on the other side of the break, and we've got a massive weekend coming up. Let's get the latest from Sportsbet.
There's some money around for the Western Bulldogs here with no McStay in that forward line, no Eric Hipwood. The money's definitely come for the Dogs. We had double the bets in early markets. Big win, little win market, 1-39. That's where most of the money's been. Not expecting a 40-plus display in this one. And the line at the moment, which I like, is the Bulldogs at 8.5. Now, players at the Gabba, Charlie Cameron. Have a look at his last 4 weeks at the Gabba. He's been on fire. Do they have a matchup for him? So I think he goes in for 3 goals in this game. Charlie Cameron to kick 3 goals. But you talk about stats, and these players get a lot of the football. The value is Lions, and I think McCluggage is in there as well, Zorko, and also Caleb Daniel for me is big value. So they go into my same game, Marty. I think the Bulldogs can get the line. Then Jared Lyons to get that 25. So too, Caleb Daniel. Good luck if you're punting in this game, but please gamble responsibly.
You're watching Finals Footy on Fox, post-game, brought to you by Industry Superfunds. You're watching Finals Footy on Fox, post-game, brought to you by Industry Superfunds.
Have a look at how big Saturday is looking right here on Fox Footy, kicking off all the action from 6 p.m. It's the semi-final at the Gabba. They will be making some noise trying to get the Brisbane Lions home. But the Bulldogs are the ones coming to town with a little bit of form. So that's going to play out beautifully. All the action right here on Fox Footy from 6 p.m. The boys on bounce following that up. Who knows what they'll get up to. In fact, we haven't even worked that out yet. And then first crack straight after bounce. So a lot to look forward to. A massive Saturday on Fox Footy. Right now, we're checking with a Chobani key moment of the match, and we're going to go with a goal to Jeremy Cameron that was kicked just before half-time. He played a very good game, kicked a couple of goals, Jeremy Cameron. This is a very much a key moment. So he leads up on Connor Iden, takes the contested mark. He's then able to play on, snap the goal, and what this did just before half-time was give them the breathing space they needed. Made the margin 22 points, and the Cats never looked back. So fantastic, Chobani, key moment of the match. Jeremy Cameron there. All right, now it's time for Wreck-It Ralph. Now, Johnny Ralph, don't take it easy on these blokes and don't let them sit on the fence. Fire it up, please.
Welcome to Wreck-It Ralph. So I figure I might as well start with you, Jason Dunstall, because you keep telling us what a great friend you are of Alistair Clark's and you're the kingmaker. Now, we hear this weekend through the Herald Sun that Alistair Clarkson for the second time has said no to the Carlton Football Club. So, has Carlton totally balls this up and have they scared Alistair Clarkson off with all the bald instability and all the dramas at that football club?
Well, I don't think they've scared him off. He just said he wants to take 12 months off. Why wouldn't you? I mean, he's certainly going to get back into coaching at some stage in the future. It hasn't been a seamless transition for Carlton. I think we're all aware of that. They've got some work to do. But the most important thing is, regardless of all the things that are happening around the peripheral and all the media attention, get the decision right.
Well, why wouldn't you want to coach Carlton?
This is your best
option to potentially not guarantee you a premiership. It's a pretty good list.
Guaranteeing a premiership.
No, it's not going to guarantee a premiership.
You're smoking something over there, Ralph.
He's not going to go and coach Gold Coast, which are 7 years away from a premiership. Surely the only thing he can...
You're now saying that Alistair Clarkson will only coach if he thinks he's going to win a premiership straight away.
Yeah, chase flags.
Wow. You must know him better than I do.
They made a mistake not getting out, man. I need to get Dunstall Carlton first.
Move on. Get
the chief to be the chief.
Nick, come on. You are mates with Ross Lyon. Have Carlton totally balls this up and scared off Ross Lyon?
This will be good.
It would appear so from the outside. Like, royally stuffed it up.
That's an easy answer.
So we can only judge it by what we see from the outside. So for all intents and purposes, it looks like, OK, well, we'll keep Teague on the hook while we're trying to get Clarko sorted. No, soft landing Ross. No. So, I mean, how's David Teague feeling right now? I think for a coach there would be a level of comfort if it was a Clarkson or a Lyon, because you say, OK, you know what, I get it, they're great coaches. But right now it's a process, it's an unknown. They've said they're not going to go with an untried coach. Mm-hmm. Is that accurate?
Yeah, experienced, the best coach, experienced coach.
That list is getting pretty small.
Mm. So do they sell him a pup when they said, you know, you're a man, and all of a sudden they put two of six members on a coaching subcommittee who he knows are not going to appoint him as coach?
Mm. Ideally you have people on the panel that are going to be impartial. And I think with some of the appointments that was never going to be the case, and Ross put two and two together.
They're not going to go with a coach with training wheels.
Yes, I'm not sure where Chris Judd was this year, so he was supposed to be the man that was going to help him.
Diesel's in there now.
He retired at some stage during the year, but he only retired officially at the end of the season. I won't ask you whether they have sold Michael Voss a pup and whether he's interested as well. Because, Brownie, I'll ask you this one. If the Lions go out in straight sets, and it's a big if, have they wasted their best shot at a flag? They could have won a Gabba Grand Final, didn't even get there, and now another chance?
No, they missed a chance last year. I think they've been crueled by injuries this year, which every team can happen, but clearly their deficiencies were the key forwards. You know, that was one of the improvements. They get Danaher in. Unfortunately, they lost Hipwood and McStay to concussion for this particular game. So I don't think they missed the window, because I think their age demographic is still pretty good.
One word, can they still win the flag this year?
Yes, of course they can, because they're still in the finals.
OK. Nick, Luke Parker's a free agent. He's asking for 4 years at $700,000. Sydney's offered 2 years at, you know, at the very most $600,000. Is that an offer that he should refuse? And can you find a landing spot for him, you know, given he's 29 in October?
It depends what you want to prioritise as a player. Now, clearly, he's a premiership player, so he's been able to tick that box. But I think Sydney, they're on the cusp again. So they're going to be relevant for the next 4 or 5 years with the young talent that they've been able to accumulate over the past few seasons. Clearly, Luke Parker is a massive part of it. Best and fairest winner, three-time best and fairest winner. So he'll play the 4 years at Sydney on probably decent money. So to leave, to have the 4 years guaranteed compared to two, I think you back yourself in and you try and hang around and win another one.
Missed one game in 6 years, so...
He's durable.
Good
body's not an issue.
Yeah.
So you'd like the security, but I think you'd back yourself in and try and win another one.
Nick, you do a lot of work with John Brown. What do you hear? Lee Matthews told me this, Michael Voss, Jason Ackermanis. Now, we didn't hear boo from you, Brownie, about Craig McRae. All of a sudden, he's the Collingwood senior coach. All of a sudden, he's your best mate. Oh, and this is extraordinary. So we've heard about the man...
No, that was Acker.
Oh, OK, all right.
Acker during the week, you know, he told him to go for the job.
Yes, I might get a gig there. So, anyway, you've told us about the Mad Monday. What encapsulate this bloke? Give us a story that it's about what makes him...
Well, yeah, we've heard about his coaching experience. He's a wonderful team man. He was the morale leader. The real driver of all those sorts of things. Loved his teammates. Mm-hmm. First day of pre-season, the year after he retired, we'd always go for the same run... about a 10K run, and we're running along about 5Ks in.
Yep.
Yeah, who's that bloke up there? He's got his feet up on the esky, having a couple of quiet cans, towelling hat on, none other than Craig McRae, cheering the boys. How are you, boys? Cheer the boys as we run past. We came back 5Ks later. He's still there. So he just loved
it.
He was 8 cans in. He had to get a lift home for his missus, actually. So anyway, he's a ripper. He's going to be a fantastic coach. He's got all the categories. Chief knows him well. He's very diverse in all the areas of coaching, so well done to him.
So, Brownie, you got another podcast. Is that right? Everyone's got a podcast. You've got a podcast. Now, Gillon McLachlan's on it. I understand that. Nick Riewoldt, you're on it.
Yeah, well, that's right. He's the big star. We're getting really on next week to chat about it. Well, you said yes.
Oh, yeah, well, yeah.
Jason, who would require more cash, Gillon McLachlan or the blonde bloke over there, to get on a podcast?
Well, Gil's always got the game at heart, Ralphie. Mm-hmm.
Whereas, keeper of the code, yes.
Whereas Rui's got his hip pocket at heart. It all depends how big the envelope is and what's in it.
I'm a company man. It's a News Corp podcast, isn't it?
It is News Corp podcast. Yeah, so we've got Gil on asking about his hair.
Just giving back.
Don't know what we're going to talk to you about. And we've also got Leper on.
Very nice.
So we're going to ask him whether he'll be going with Craig McRae to Collingwood.
Get it? We're all your News Corp podcast.
When are you doing it, Jase?
That's right.
Wrap it up, Ralphie. You're
done. It's no sacked, but it'll be okay.
Brownie's podcast.
It's Brownie's podcast.
We'll get you on one day, Ralphie, when we're short of content.
Hey, I got my own podcast. There you go. These boys are okay.
I love how much time Brownie put into the thought around the name of his podcast.
That's
Brownie's.
Well,
Brownie's
Campbell Brown.
What a cracker.
Campbell Brown's in it as well.
Just stop talking
Campbell
for a minute.
Campbell Brown's
stop
in it.
Stop talking
well.
For
listen,
one
listen,
minute
listen.
Because we're heading back to Optus Stadium and the press conference of Victoria's coach Chris Scott.
How satisfying is that, Chris?
Yeah, it's satisfying, Lockie. We played better. We knew we needed to, but I think, as I said pre-game, we have been a pretty consistent unit over a long period of time and have great confidence that our best footy is hard to beat. And we were closer to that tonight. And there's a little bit of a circuitous route, but we're where we want to be.
Did you feel you had a point to prove as a group this week after some of the external commentary, which you might not have been across anyway, but did you feel there was a point to prove?
It's not the way we work. I don't really believe in that extrinsic motivation anyway. I think it's good theatre for the game. I understand why that question is asked and why you might wonder whether we use it, but we don't. We don't think it's very valuable, and we think it takes our minds off what we do best. We had a bad one. It happens, even to good teams. And so we just needed to concentrate on what we do well, and I thought we got back to that pretty well tonight.
Chris, have you considered what the shape of that game would be? And, of course, it's a different universe with Jeremy Cameron playing for them, bearing in mind their forward issues. And not for you, even though you had Tom, who was dominant. Just a combination of those two players compared to what they had.
No, not really. I had a few other things on my mind other than those weird hypotheticals. But they would be weird if I were thinking them. I understand why you would be. Give me a couple of days to think about it, and I'll give you a more considered answer.
But what I
will say is I think it would be bordering on offensive to say that the performance tonight was good because we had Jeremy Cameron and they didn't.
Tom Hawkins. That was pretty significant too.
Yeah, well, any good team has good players and they were significant, but that's not the question you asked.
what was it, Chris, about your game tonight that showed you you're back where you are and you're playing your game the way you want to?
Yeah, I thought that we let ourselves down a little bit with the way we defended last week. By that, it wasn't even when the opposition had the ball necessarily. It happened a little bit before that. Our contest work was better, which allowed us to defend better. I thought our players ahead of the ball looked much more dangerous and challenged the opposition a lot more. So I say quite regularly, without going into detail, we strongly believe that the three phases of the game have to fit together, and if one's off, it affects the others. So we just had two really bad parts of our game, big picture, last week that we needed to address. We were beaten in the contest too much, which put us on the back foot defending.
The venue becomes really important. You had a big win against Fremantle earlier in the season. You looked great tonight. How are you finding Optus Stadium and playing your style here?
Yeah, we love it here. I mean, I'll go back a little bit further just to highlight how we've, as a club, adapted to life on the road and hub life. And we would have preferred to be at home last year with our families, but the upside was we got some time together. And I thought our players, our coaching staff, our whole club generally responded to those challenges really well and embraced the situation that we're in. And that's been our experience here in Perth. We're in hotel quarantine in Adelaide, so it started there. But you're right, I think the ground, for some reason, suits our eye. We have defended it well. The numbers suggest that. It was pretty clear to us from late in the season that we were going to play our finals in Perth. So the equation's still the same for us. Win three games in Perth. We're excited at that opportunity.
Chris, well done tonight. 11 preliminary finals now in the last 15 years. Can I just ask you if you'd look ahead for a second? You come up against a side who's played in four finals in 15 years. As a player and a coach that's been involved in a lot of them, Chris, does it give you a slight advantage, even if mentally, coming up in such a big game with so much more experience on that stage than your opponents?
I always find that hard to quantify. I think we will have some confidence because we've been here before, but as I try to stress without, you know, being defensive or having the argument, every year is a new year. The short-term experience does help a bit, so the last year or two. I'm not sure that our final series in 2011 is going to help us much. We've got three players left. I think it goes to a different point, which is the external side of things, the theatre, which should be embraced. I'm not arguing against it. I'm certainly not suggesting that anyone should not talk about those things. That's their prerogative, and it probably does have some relevance in terms of the theatre. But what's real for us is the team we've become over the last 2 to 3 years max. So we're confident we can play well this week, but gee, the longer you go in the season, the harder it gets. When you play high quality opposition, that's sort of, it's one of the things when you finish top four, you know you're going to play really good teams.
Did you like what Radaglia brought tonight? And will his potential selection or non-selection depend on what that looks like for the tall Melbourne defence?
Oh, look, I thought he was really strong. We don't make a habit of commenting in detail around the status of our players, but I'm happy to say now, Asava was a little bit sore a couple of weeks ago and was, you know, he was unavailable. So now that he's available, we think that that's a really viable option. I was pleased with what he gave tonight.
Chris, how compromised is our danger with that finger? Is it a ligament and is it restricting him? I know he did pretty well tonight with 20 possessions, but what's the real story with his injury?
Tom, that's your job. It's not my job to tell you. Your job is to squirrel around and make all your phone calls and do your investigations. I'm not going to make it that easy for you, mate.
And just from a midfield perspective, do you think Selwood and Danger have got another gear in them or two to sort of run with Oliver and Petrarca next week?
Oh, it'd be a good battle. I'd love to see those two with an extra gear. That'd be exciting for everyone. But, you know, it's the conversation's changed a little bit internally around, you know, the depth of our midfield, and it's going to be tested a little bit more with Parfitt going down. But even tonight's a good example, I thought. you know, he's an important part of our midfield, but we were able to cover pretty well. So, and that wasn't saying Pat and Joel, you guys have got to do it by yourself.
And do you think you'll persist with Mitch Duncan in that high half forward role? And he still had 23 touches playing a slightly adjusted role tonight.
Yeah, well, he's only played half the season and he's gone back to the role he was playing. So we haven't really adjusted it that much.
Chris, how much in terms of
you go, Mitch.
Just on Asava Radicalea, how much did Alia's performance last week and the power defence sort of owning your forwards and your high half forwards impact on his selection tonight?
Well, we review every game, but as I said, Asava, in my mind, you know as well as anyone, Mitch, that I really rate Asava and we're really confident in the player he can become. So there are a whole lot of things that factored into it, but I wouldn't isolate it to the way our forward line functioned last week. Sure, it had a part to play in our decision-making, but when Sav's up and going, he's hard to keep out of our team.
You've only played Radicalea, Stanley, Hawkins and Cameron in the same side three times this year. Further to what Sam asked next week, does he come into your thinking to limit Lever, given what he did to you in the second half against Melbourne 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago?
Yeah, but let's be clear, Mitch. I know you're not suggesting that we chose not to play them. Jeremy Cameron's missed half the year. Sav's had his issues. Reece has had his issues as well. So I'm going to suggest that the times that we had those guys available to play together, we did that.
I'm sure it's a realistic chance to play in the grand final if you get that.
Yeah, we think he is. That's the feedback we're getting. He's ahead of schedule, which I find humorous. When the guy's walking upstairs and that's ahead of schedule. but the feedback is, well, let me be really clear. We were strong and I don't get involved in the minutiae of the medical decision-making, but we need to be really clear as a club that we weren't going to put his long-term future at risk by trying to rush him back for a final. So if he makes really good progress and we're clear, and the medical staff are clear that the risk is very, very low, then we're open to the possibility, but he's not going to play this week.
What do you know about Parfitt's injury at the moment? How serious is that?
Craig, it's a hamstring that didn't look good. So this close to the completion of the game, I never have a really good picture of these sort of injuries, but I think you can join the dots a little bit that it's not a minor hamstring, so that will put him in some doubt.
Do you know if you're allowed to leave the hotel to get that scanned or anything like that in your quarantine position?
Yes, yeah, we are. There are obviously really tight restrictions around that, as there should be, but there is a procedure that we can follow to make sure that we look after the public here but also get our players the medical care that they need.
And when do you get out of quarantine? Is it Friday, given you went to South Australia earlier in the week, or do those days in SA not count as part of your cleanness?
No, they have to count. They have to count. You've never seen quarantine like it. So if that didn't count, nothing does. So, yeah, we're out. I don't think we'll be out midnight Thursday. I think we'll be asleep. But, yeah, effectively. I'm just double checking you guys. Yeah, Friday will be out. Friday.
Are you prep?
Okay, sorry, we're having a side discussion here. Our people aren't making any sense, and they're blaming it on others.
It's confusing for everyone. Hey, Chris, are you proud? I mean, you might not have time right now to be thinking about it, and I know you've got a couple more weeks at least that you want out of this season, but how proud are you to be here once again?
Sam, I'm proud of our coaching group. They've done a terrific job over a long period of time now. And I think our whole club, I'm proud to be a part of this club. We support each other really strongly, but there's high accountability as well. We've got high expectations and we don't shy away from that. And then the players, I couldn't get a better bunch of players to work with. It's a joy to coach them.
Chris, you do a lot right in the second week of finals. What is it about this week that's so reassuring? You just front up every time and get the job done often after an ordinary first week of the finals.
So who is that? Is that you, Jake?
Ashley Brown.
Oh, Ashley. I mean, I'll just reference what I said earlier. I don't mean to be combative or defensive, but we just don't reference stuff that happened 750 days ago.
Is Quinton Arkell's best chance of getting back into this team as an inside mid to replace Brandon Parfitt?
It's too early for me to speculate on that. I'll let you go to work, Mitch. You've got a pretty good handle on it, so you'll know who the candidates are.
Chris.
One more, guys.
Was the game against Melbourne in round 23? Is the game in Melbourne in round 23, is that of any relevance to Friday, or do you just wipe it?
No, I don't
Given
think
that
so.
Was so close and yeah.
Yeah, I guess that would be the point that I try to make as coherently as possible. Games that were 25 days away or 25 days ago, whatever the number is, are more relevant than games that were 950 games away. So, yeah, there's some things because even if both of those teams wanted to, you couldn't turn your game style on its head. So there is some relevance there. But the last time you played a team is always relevant. But I think if you rely on the things that happen in the game, you get surprised. So it's an interesting game to have a look at because we got 44 points up. So we clearly played some pretty good footy against them. And they were really dominant in the second half. So it depends whether you're glass half full or not. But in terms of system style, what to expect, probably won't be a whole lot of surprises from either side.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks.
Thanks, Chris.
The winning Cats coach this evening, Chris Scott, their 35-point winners. They were over the Giants, and he said it's just a pretty simple equation. It just comes down to winning three games in Perth. Well, they've ticked the first one off, and there is two to come. We started with 18 teams. As of tonight, we are down to five. Our finals football experts this evening on the first crack, Dermot Brereton and Jordan Lewis.
Good evening, Cal. Dermot.
Who wants the first finals crack? Go on, Derm. You go for it.
I think I've just been delegated it. Yeah. So do I want it? I don't know. I was rapt for a professional footballer tonight, Tom Hawkins. In round 21, Tom Hawkins, I would say, was taken to the cleaners by Sam Taylor, who I still can't work out how he wasn't in the All-Australian team. Everything that Hawkins did that night, and some people wrongly have said, Sam Taylor plays back shoulder, it's risky in that. No, if you've got pace, the worst place for a forward to find his opponent is back shoulder because he can see the ball, he can see you. And if he's got pace to shut you down on the lead, we hate it. We hated it. I hated it.
He was best on ground that night. Oh, he was, Geelong. Was yeah. 17 intercept marks or something like that? He got the record?
He was the most complete backman's game that night. Fast forward to tonight, and Taylor was in his head that night. Couldn't lead on him because he shut him down on the lead. And then he actually spread his legs to him and thought, I'll push against him. But he played him from behind so he couldn't get a feel on him and Taylor would leave him and intercept the ball. So he was completely in his head. In the end, Tom stopped leading. Tonight, he went to school on that outing. A professional player said, I need to see where Sam Taylor is. The amount of marks he took against him tonight, he took four contested marks and he actually was able to then turn it around and find space in front for the short leads. And Taylor was trying to avoid contact, so getting away. This is what I say he did. He knew it. That's kind of half fortunate, but he overpowered him. He knew where Sam Taylor was tonight. He didn't allow him back shoulder. I reckon he backpedaled on him a bit and got the feeling of, I've got him here, I can overpower him, I know where he's at, bang, four contested marks again. And there was a little push one, the first one I came down. It was such a smart game. It's so easy for people to say, oh, he had motivation to come out and win. Everyone's got motivation to come out and beat their opponent. But to actually understand the strengths of your opponent, understand your strengths and say, I can fix this. I can get a better starting position and it will play into my favour. And that's what Tom Hawkins did tonight. you can teach an old dog new tricks, or a cat in this case. 300 games. 300 games.
Yeah, and I mean, we talk about September and finals experience, and you two are beautiful examples of that. And then you've got Taylor, who's 22 and played 50 games. And then you've got Tom Hawkins, who's 33 and played 301.
He was on the move a little bit more. The connection was
better. But he got him where he wanted him first.
The movement was better. The forward line was much more open. So he clearly did his homework on a specific opponent and knew that he had to get him in vulnerable positions.
And the Giants had to play Taylor on him again.
Yep.
They had to. You can't take away your winner from last time to say he's going to change his game. You've got to go with him again.
Yep. All right. We've got Leon Cameron. We're going to hear from the Giants coach very, very shortly. I think one of us here are going to make a bold statement about Leon Cameron a little later. But first of all, you go with your crack.
Well, I think the Cats found their clutch. And what I mean by that is in their ball movement, I think they've been stuck in first and second gear for the past month, and they haven't been able to move the ball. Clearly, Tom Stewart out is a key reason for that, and Tui being out last week as well. So they had no run and drive, and it looked to me like the Cats defenders that played last week, one, didn't want the ball in their hands, but certainly when they had the ball in their hands, they didn't know how to move the ball aggressively as Zach Tui did. So Zach Tui comes into the side. He plays halfback in the first quarter, has 12 disposals, but certainly helped with their ball movement from D50 to forward 50.
11. Set up that second goal, I think, to close.
Close goal. So
quicker. They were so slow. Absolutely. Looked slow against Port Adelaide last week.
So 11 times they had a chance to transition the ball. Four inside, forward 50. Parfitt goes out injured, which meant Tui had to go to the wing because Menengola goes into the middle of the ground. So they lose that drive out of half-back. So then they go 16 times in the second quarter for one inside forward 50 when he's not there. So I think they'll get another player in for the Parfitt injury. Tui goes back to half-back and they just look more settled. They were able to change gears within game and they look more dangerous, which gave the forwards better looks inside forward 50.
All righty. Before we have a look, even we're going to preview, obviously, tomorrow night and then next Friday night as well. Two of the oldest AFL clubs, VFL clubs, going round in Melbourne and Geelong to play off for a spot in the grand final. But first of all, the GWS Giants. So they finished 10th last year. They had just the 8 wins. This year, they're going to finish 6th after 12 wins when you take into account the final win last week. 12 and a draw we'll give them. Let's hear from their coach, Leon Cameron.
First of all, commiserations on the loss. So a few brave fight backs in there. What did you make of the overall performance?
Yeah, look, the disappointing thing was probably every quarter they probably just got us by a goal or two. And, whether that's experience, right thing, right time, trying to make up ground was hard. Look, we hung in there and we were really courageous because we didn't roll over and we kept on fighting to the end. But, it's a learning curve. We're a young team tonight. Really proud of them that they had a crack against a really mature side that does the right thing at the right time a lot more than probably what we did tonight. But, we had equal inside 50s. We did a lot right, but just didn't get our reward when we went forward.
How much did you miss Hogan tonight? Just someone who could take those really strong contested marks?
Yeah, look, he's been, terrific, Nick, in terms of that part of the game, that aspect of the game. Look, it's not ideal, but it is what it is. You've got to deal with it. And having him down there as a, big key target, no doubt would have, it causes another threat to Geelong's defence, but we didn't have that. We tried some stuff at the, three-quarter time with Haynes down there, and when the game looked like it was done and dusted and Isaac coming, we put down there as well. But, we'll learn from it. You can't sit back and say, if we had player A, B or C, we've been dealing with injuries all year and we had to deal with it again tonight.
How serious was the injury and could he have played next week if you had won?
Oh, it looks just touch and go. He was sore, a day after the game last week. We gave him every opportunity right up to the, a couple of hours out, and then we made that decision. So it's a bit of a touch and go. He sort of recovered from the injury well, I think, throughout the year on one occasion, but equally he missed 4 or 5 weeks on another. So that would have been interesting.
Leon has a bit of a throw forward just on Hogan again. I mean, how concerning is it that he's had so many niggles and setbacks this year?
Oh, clearly you want players out there more than not, but I mean, you know, it's his first year. We're sort of trying to, you know, get to work out how much, you know, his training management, his load, what he can do and what he can't do. I think the good thing about it is, you know, he goes away after a season where he's played 9 or 10 games, probably the most he's done for a while. Clearly, we want that up to 15 or 16 games, but we just need to make sure that we get his pre-season right. I mean, he's had some setbacks in his period of time that led to probably a couple of soft tissue injuries, but that's the job of the high performance guys and our medical staff to work out what works and what doesn't. So, we've got that challenge when we resume training later on this year.
And obviously it's still pretty raw, Leon, but now that the season is over, how are you going to look back at this season?
I think we played a lot of young kids, an enormous amount of young kids. We went in probably up to a dozen times this year into games where we were extremely young and probably one of the youngest sides going around. So it's dangerous by saying that holds you in good stead because every year is different. But no doubt that experience that a lot of those players have had, especially the back end of this year when we're playing in a lot of cutthroat games where we had to win, you know, puts an understanding in players' minds that, if you want to compete at the pointy end, you have to, turn up more than not. And so, really good finish to the year, bit of up and down throughout the middle part of the year. But overall, it's a real positive. We know we've been on the road for a while and that helps, relationships build. And, we can't wait to get back, home to see our families and friends, but equally next year when you get to play in front of your home crowd. And so, it's a hard one to answer because, an hour ago or 45 minutes ago, we lost a final that would have progressed us into a prelim. So that's disappointing.
Is there a sense of frustration in that sense, Leon? I think the common view is you've done enormously well, particularly in the back part of the year. You've had personnel issues tonight from a suspension perspective and, big injuries. I mean, you must have reflected in that last 10 minutes, geez, you've had those players, you would have run pretty close, I reckon.
Oh, look, it is frustrating at times. We're trying to, you clearly want a healthy list out there as much as you can. But I suppose when you have Keith go down with a knee and Buckley go down with a knee and Bruce with the shoulder and Kennedy with the shoulder and even tonight, young Sproul, a shoulder. I mean, there's some really nasty injuries there that you don't want to wish upon anyone. It's the nature of the game. Sometimes I sit there and think, are we going too hard? Do we need to pull ahead at times? But that's just the one thing I love about our footy club is we crash and bash and we put our bodies on the line. So we need to keep looking at ways that we can make sure that we get a number of players out in the park, more than what we've had this year. But it's not just one thing, it's a number of things.
Leon, you said earlier that, each year is a new year, but the sort of resilience you guys were able to develop throughout the year with so long on the road, is that something you think you can sort of come back to in the future?
There's no doubt having experience in resilient situations is great, but you guys know as well as I do that in 2 or 3 weeks' time there'll be a premier that will be the best side in the competition to win and hold up the cup, and then when that final siren goes, it's 18 sides are on again. They start from scratch. We start from scratch again, and we're under no illusions that we need to improve to make sure we get back here again next year. And that's the challenge. We've been to finals 5 out of the last 6 years, but we ultimately haven't got to where we wanted to get to, and that's win the premiership. So really proud that we've sort of not rebuilt, but just reset on the run with a number of young kids, as I mentioned before. And those guys have really surprised us a little bit. But if they want a piece of the action, they've got to go away, rest up, and then come back with a good pre-season and stake their claim again.
Shane Mumford, do you know if he plays on next year?
Oh, look, it's probably highly unlikely. He's retired a couple of times, Mummy. It was an emotional time after the game. You could clearly see he was shattered. For a player that was probably only going to play 4 or 5 games and just coach the young fellas in the ruck this year, it turned out to play a bit more than probably what we first thought. We managed him really well. We got a really good performance out of him. Even his second half was just unbelievably built on courage. And our players actually see that and they love having him out there. But, you know, he's 35, he's banged up, he can, you know, probably hardly move. But it's probably more unlikely than likely. And, you know, but we'll search our way through that and discuss that in the next couple of months.
Liam, I think it's a common view that we want to see Toby Green, fans want to see Toby Green playing his best footy and kicking goals for you guys. At the appropriate time in the off-season, will you sit down and talk to him about those discipline issues and his sort of issues during with suspension during finals?
Oh, look, we all know. I mean, there's a lot spoken about this. And the good thing about it, the club, you know, got on with things this week and put the disappointment behind us and then and got on and played, you know, a pretty tough brand of footy. I understand he's a, you know, a huge talking point and he's a, you know, he's a wonderful player for us. And we know that things didn't go to plan last week and he needs to put his hand up. But, yeah, that'll do. When the dust has settled over the next couple of months, we're going to make sure that, you know, he's out there more times than not because he's not only great for our footy club, he's great for the game. But we've got some challenges and we're not going to hide away from that. We're not going to shy away from that. We've got some challenges and we'll work through them over the pre-season.
Leon, has Toby apologised at all for his actions last week and costing the team in a big game?
Oh, I think you're a bit harsh in saying that. I mean, we had a number of players out. It's not just one player that cost the team. But in terms of his apology, absolutely. You know, he's in front of the group and clearly remorseful throughout the week. And it was an emotional, you know, 10 or 15 minutes in front of our entire group throughout the week. It's just, but we're not a club that's going to shy away from things. You know, we need to, you know, work out the rights and the wrongs. And we got it wrong last weekend and he puts his hand up. But equally, I said throughout the week, you don't give up on these players because they're like your children. You know, and sometimes your kids do some things wrong, you know, something's wrong in life and they need to learn from it and then and move on. But he's been a wonderful player for us and I'm really confident they'll work through some of those challenges over the pre-season.
On the human side sometimes gets forgotten in circumstances like this. So how's Toby holding up and how is he in the rooms after the loss today?
I'd be disappointed, be you know, be feeling it. I mean, Jesse would be the same. Adam Kennedy wanted to play, he'd be the same. It goes on and on and on. They want to play, which is great. But they'll be disappointed. But it is what it is. Credit to Geelong. You know, we bow out. We've got to lick our wounds, learn from it and put it behind us and move on to having a break first, you know, a well-earned break. But then trying to become a better club every year you present yourself.
You had Leon, all indications are that Jacob Hopper is going to re-sign. Like, how much of a benefit is it that you're probably not going to, at this stage, lose a key player like you have probably for 4, 5, 6 years now?
Yeah, well, I hope you're right, Mark. I mean, I mean, I'm really confident that Jacob, you know, will put pen to paper. He probably just wanted to get the season over and done with And he's had a really, you know, that head knock he had a few weeks ago was really nasty and probably knocked him around for a few weeks. So, look, he's a wonderful player from us. He's out of our academy. He's been there since he arrived, I think, the end of 2015. So, he settled in Sydney and, you know, he owns his house in Sydney. Like, he's, every all indicators will be at our footy club. But, yeah, I mean, no doubt, you know, over the upcoming period, it would be good to be a quiet one for us.
Leon, what's your message progress, to... With the progress the younger players have shown and I guess the club making a semi-final, even with all the upheavals and disruptions that you've had, would you look to add some experience talent to the group to see how much further they can go?
Oh, look, it's always dangerous answering those questions straight after, you know, a loss. I think we'll assess and make decisions over the next, you know, month or so to look at that. I mean, you're always looking to add value at the list on your list. We've done some really good job in bringing some mature age players in the past. You've seen De Boer and Keefe and the players that that have come in and had a second chance. But equally, I'm really bullish about going to the draft again. You know, we had a really good opportunity to see some kids from last year's draft, Bruin, Stone, you know, I'm really excited about seeing young Ryan Engwin play some footy next year. I think he's just starting to get going. So, you know, I think the future holds us in really good stead with some of these kids that are coming through. So, you know, we've got some, you know, good picks there, and no doubt we'll probably go there. But no, that discussion over the next month will be had with obviously the powers to be to work out what we do.
And with the young players that have come in with sort of filling in with injuries and giving you an opportunity to try different things, have you found that there's any areas you think you need to work on or focus on in the off season?
Oh, I mean, I think general improvement, you're always looking across the whole board. But, I mean, in terms of specific areas, again, it's real dangerous trying to pinpoint that now. I think after a really good review in the next 3 or 4 weeks, you know, every club has their reviews every year and we'll do the same. We'll have a look at it. We'll let the dust settle and we'll say, okay, where are we short? Where do we need to improve? Where's our short on our, you know, where's the gaps in our list? So I look forward to doing that and working through that with some of our boys and then and making appropriate decisions over that period of October, November.
Leon, how hard is it to get back into Sydney now? What's the program to sort of get home? And there might be some difficulties associated with going back there, but you'll be desperate to see your families.
Yeah, you're right, Tom. I think no doubt our players, you know, whether we go to Melbourne or I think it's first stop's probably Melbourne and then back to Sydney after that. And we're going to work through those border issues for our players' breaks, who can stay where and who can get into where. I mean, no doubt a lot of the interstate clubs are doing that at the moment. So, but yeah, no, it'll be good to see family and friends after being away for 10 weeks. But equally, it's sort of you walk out of here and there's an empty feeling. You know, you want to play more finals footy. So our players are pretty flat and upset at the moment. But we, we've got to acknowledge that they were a bit too good for us and then we move on.
Leon, what's your stance on vaccinations? It's probably a tough question again so soon after a match and obviously you're the coach, not the footy boss, but what's your stance on that? Would you like to see the guys all get vaccinated?
Yeah. You're asking me some pretty political questions there, Mark. Look, no doubt for us to move around and travel throughout Australia, it's common sense to get vaccinated. And no doubt our staff have been through a lot of that and our players will as well. And I think I read an article from the Kangaroos as well. I think the AFL, you know, getting behind that. And if it means that we can travel a little bit more to, you know, put on a game of football for people to watch, that's only been a good thing because navigating your way through what we've seen this year is always going to be tough. But, it's always a hard one to answer.
So Leon Cameron there, the coach of the GWS Giants, after they were knocked out of the finals, 35-point losers in the end to the Cats this evening. In Perth, he was extensive. He had spoke really well, you've got to say, revealing that Toby Green apologised, spent about 10 to 15 minutes speaking to the group earlier this week and apologising after his suspension, and that Shane Mumford was really emotional, having played what we believe will be his final AFL game. We got to you two having a quick crack. I'm going to have a quick crack if that's
what's
okay.
Your crack?
My crack this evening is that Leon Cameron, stop giggling. Leon Cameron should be the coach of the year. And before you disagree with me, you might disagree with me on this one, Derm. Those have gone really early, you know, the start of this year, end of last year, that, you know, they went really early that he should be the coach that was in the hot seat and maybe, you know, was under the most pressure, that he was too nice to coach, that he'd been given this highly skilled team and in the last few years hadn't been able to win a premiership, that he hadn't converted all this talent. They lost their first three. He was criticised for that fly-on-the-wall documentary. And then they lost more players than any other team to injury, when you consider that. They've been on the road since June 22. They haven't slept in their own bed for 70-odd nights. They've travelled from Sydney to Melbourne to Brisbane to Gold Coast to Melbourne to Tassie to Perth, and they've made it all the way through to a semi-final. So, and they've had wins over Melbourne at the MCG. They've had wins over Geelong in Geelong and their arch-rival Sydney in another final. They're 3-0 over the Swans in finals.
Ms.
Is that a good case? Am I mounting a good case here?
Absolutely. I'm in heated agreement with you.
Oh.
But so I will say, he's got some really stiff competition.
And I mean, the dialogue around post round three was right, the year is over for the Giants. Yep. They've got to go back to the drawing board now. They've got to get kids coming through. Well, you know what? They kind of have. A lot of kids come through, and he's coached exceptionally well for all those reasons you've mentioned. But if I can just list, I thought we might go in this area. So he's made an increase of, he's gone from 10th to 7th this year, an increase of only 3 games. Fantastic, any increase. Mm. But for those reasons you've said, because he was up against it. John Longmire's had an increase of 10 wins for the year. Simon Goodwin, 8+ in terms of the win list. Kenny Hinckley, same as last year. He's actually slipped from first to second after the home and away. Ben Rutten has gone from 13th to 8th with +5 wins. You would think that of those coaches, only the +3 wins in terms of the ledger for Leon Cameron. I still think you'd find it tough to find a coach who's been harder up against it since round 22 last year
and loses Cameron.
Yeah,
and loses Cameron at the end of the year. So they finished 10th.
Exactly.
Lose arguably your best power forward.
Yep.
And then you come up against them, funnily enough, tonight. You mentioned the Fly on the Wall documentary. After watching that, he would be the coach that I would love to be coached by.
Oh, right.
Out of all of those coaches, and I understand the younger demographic these days like the cuddlier type.
Yeah.
But he was fantastic. And I thought he did a great job.
He was the most criticised character is the wrong word, but, you know, figure that agreed to do it out of all of them. And at 0-3, people were saying it was a mistake.
Yeah, he was. I mean, they start the season 2-4. I think he's been fantastic. Having been under him as an assistant coach and then see the way that he's gone about it, he's had injuries all throughout the year, missing key players at key times. And a lot of those injuries were late withdrawals from sides. But I just think he's been fantastic. He's got the most out of his group, even tonight. He got the most out of that group. They challenged it at certain times in the game, yet they just ran out of gas.
He's got one veteran in the back line, Hainsey. The next veteran is the 53-gamer, I think, Sam Taylor.
Yeah.
And then you go to blokes like Connor Iden, who was pick 61. Then you've got blokes who were off their rookie list who've come into their team. Now, we keep thinking of the Giants, and fair enough, they do. Their list is full of first-rounders. But the amount of rookie list players, rookie upgrades, he gets up to speed is incredible.
Okay.
So he must have something going for him.
So we're with you. Sense.
You're with me. I didn't need to do my big spiel. I just said Leon Cameron is the coach of the year.
Johnny Longmire and Simon Goodwin
will probably have
a good
I'm with
run
you on that.
It.
Let's take a quick break and then we'll find out who you think Melbourne and Geelong next Friday night.
Yep.
And maybe one of your favourite players, if not your favourite player, might have been farewell tonight. We'll be back right after this.
No alternative but to win. That's it.
The Dogs have started to get their bite back.
They're dog hungry.
Oh my goodness!
So here are the pictures, an emotional farewell from the Beast from Bunyip. He played his 216th and final AFL game this evening, a Swans Premiership player, started with the Cats. He was meant to play only 4 or 5 games for the Giants this year, ended up playing 14. The 35-year-old will be the ruck coach for the Giants next year. And I would say Dermot Brereton, he'd have to be in your top 3 all-time favourite players at the moment.
All-time? Well, he's definitely...
Sorry, top 3 going round now.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Ben Cunnington, love him. And I love Toby.
I love
James Sicily, but he's not going round at the moment. fantastic bloke, Shane. And I think if you asked Dave Matthews, in your time at the Giants, Dave, tell us who the most important player is. Not the best, the most important player for this group, he would say Shane Mumford.
And it's not just on field, but it's off field. He's mentored Jesse Hogan and been able to help him get himself back on track as well this year.
Yeah, I think he's been huge for Jesse. I mean, he's given over and above for this GWS Giants side. He might have played 3 or 4 games throughout the season. You would think they wanted to play him every round because of the influence that he was able to have. And certainly even in that second half, probably him knowing that it was about to end, he just gave absolutely everything and was at his clumsy best.
Didn't you give him a clip once, or he gave you a clip?
Yeah, something might happen overseas, but...
It's late. Come on.
I was a bit too pissed to swing him.
Why would you pick...
You tried against Shane Mumford.
Anyway, yes. So I came off second best, which is probably a good result.
Yeah, you don't want to go on any longer than one or two swings.
Hey, we got to do... Don't worry about the first crack. We need to do the midnight crack. Just keep them rolling through.
And his stories.
Yeah, we'd be here all night. Speaking of your stories, Derm, you've got the mosh mics. What do the Cats need to fix ahead of next Friday night's game at Optus Stadium against the D's for spotting the granny?
So important for this. Against the D's. Now, I heard you say they played in gears and they were so attractive. Yep. You said when they played quick out of the back line, that's great. And a lot of people say they play so much nicer footy and they're so much better when they do that. They are against certain opposition. Mm. They must do better at controlling the ball next week. And that looks ugly when they go sideways and chip and do this. They must slow it down. Because if they play fast against Melbourne on that ground... That size ground, Optus Stadium, Melbourne will, I won't say kick the sweep, but they'll have a very comfortable victory. There were times tonight when they went quick and the Giants got it going the other way. And Giants aren't a quick quick users of the ball, travelling, making the ball travel quick. And they made Geelong running backwards look a little pedestrian. Now, they tried to address that at selection table this week. The Cats, they got a fair bit of it right compared to last week. But if they try and play quick football too often next week, Melbourne will have their way with them.
Firstly, do you agree? And secondly, no Parfitt. So who would come in? You've got Higgins, who was managed, which was the polite way to put it, probably. Narkle, who's done a lot of time, been patient this year, and Dalhouse, who was dropped.
I'd give Higgins another chance. Yeah, I just think that ball use and the ability to use the ball going inside forward 50 is a handy inclusion. Narkle could be a good one as well, a bit of sort of strength around the contest.
He's been stiff when he's
some explosion out of the contest, which is similar to Parfitt. Yeah, I agree with that. But
can they beat the D's?
On that ground?
It's going to be hard because I think that the ground being as narrow it is, the defenders can recover really quickly. So if it isn't, I mean, I get they need to go slow at times, but they still need to challenge. You think about when they played down in Geelong, there was that 10 to 15 minute patch where it was out of the centre bounce, it was quicker ball movement, and they piled on 7 goals.
Perfect out of the centre bounce. Yeah, go quick out of there. But once the ball is, it's the centre bounce and then it's done what it's done, another stoppage, you cannot afford to go fast from there. Go fast out of the centre bounce.
Yeah, I think if they go slow, Lever and May will have a field day.
Yep, so it's Cats Melbourne next Friday night, Optus Stadium 7:50. They played twice this year. Round 4, it was Melbourne beating Geelong by 25 points at the MCG. And then, well, as you sort of referenced, round 23, who can forget Geelong by 4 points? Either. They were down by 44 and the D's 6 goals to none in that last quarter. Thank you very much, boys. That was the thanks to Mosh, Men's Health Made Easy. Head to getmosh.com.au. We've still got another ad break and we've still got tomorrow night's huge semi-final to preview.
And some of your stories.
Sit tight. I'm not sure about that. We might have to wait for the off-season. Let's check in with PointsBet.
Thanks very much, Kelly. Well, this one is going to be an absolute cracker. Do or die finals footy at the Gabba with the Lions hosting the Western Bulldogs. And the Lions, they are $1.60 here head-to-head if you like them. They need to find that offence that they've had throughout the season. And the Western Bulldogs, they got a bit of their mojo back last week against the Bombers. They were hard, they were tough. And if you like them head-to-head, it's $2.35 here at PointsBet. I've got a same-game multi in this one and I absolutely love it. Big Joe to respond. Didn't kick a goal last week, so I've got him 2 or more goals in this one. Zorko to sneak forward and be an anytime goal scorer, and Lachie Neal in and around the footy, 25 or more disposals for him and for the Doggies. Well, the big astronaut, I've got Tim 2 or more goals. I've got the Bont anytime goal scorer, McRae to find a heap of the footy with 25 or more disposals, and that offence, well, I spoke about it, total match points above 163.5. That gets you $13.12 here at PointsBet. If you do like that, please gamble responsibly.
This program brought to you by PointsBet. It's shacking easy to bet anytime, anywhere with the PointsBet app. And Harvey Norman Footy Finals. Don't miss a minute of the action.
Still playing. plenty of footy to come your way. Fox Footy this weekend. Of course, tomorrow night it's the Brisbane Lions in the Lions' Den hosting the Western Bulldogs. That is the first semi-final at the Gabba. There's no Hipwood. There's no McStay. So plenty of pressure on Joe Danaher, Geordie and Derm. Who wins and why?
I think Brisbane, if Caleb Daniel is the out that we think he might be, I think that provides a real hole in their ball movement. I thought the Bulldogs were great in the second half. The conditions really suited it. But I just think Brisbane at home, I think they'll get a hold of them.
Yeah, I'm the other way. I ended up going for Geelong tonight and went for a tip there. And then when Big Jesse was out, completely swung there. I'm fixed on Doggies, though. I think they've swung their game. I think they've found their little mojo back. You don't get to the top of the ladder by round 19 by not being a good team. Yeah, they've had some injuries. They know their game. They're good at their game. They're missing a couple of components of it. But so, as we say, so too of Brisbane. And I think I believe you start off the next week the way you finish the previous week. So I think they'll start all right, go all right, and I think they'll win.
Quite a few changes for the Brisbane Lions. I noticed they brought Devitt Robertson in. Mm. I reckon you went with it first about Libba. You tag Libba and then you stop the Dogs. I heard you say it on radio. Is Berry or Robertson coming in to tag? And alternatively, does Dunkley go to Neil?
Yeah, I would hope so. I'd hope they would look at that success that they've had tagging Liberatore. I thought the barometer might have been there, but he might be the medical sub and Robertson comes in and maybe performs that role. But he's so crucial to the way they move the ball from the contest to the outside. He was a big key reason why they won last week. So I'd tag him out.
Are they just going to be too small up forward, Brisbane?
I think that's an advantage. I think if they move the ball and use it inside forward 50, knowing they've got a smaller type of forward line, I think they can use that to their advantage.
All right, boys. Well, you'll find out tomorrow night. Live from 6 p.m, all the build-up. 7:20 is the first bounce of this much-anticipated semi-final. And the winner goes on to play Port Adelaide at Adelaide Oval, of course, the following week in a preliminary final. So all the big names in the house tomorrow night after the footy from 10:30. It's Jason Dunstall and the rest of the crew. And then it's first crack from 11:30. All the fallout from the game tomorrow night. For now, though, Jordan Lewis, you're going to tell us what happened with Mummy.
Good night and good morning.
No alternative but to win. That's it.
The Dogs have started to get their bite back.
They're dog hungry. Oh!